morning, everybody. Thank you for joining me this morning for the first fire of the season here. It's really cold out. We actually got quite a bit of snow yesterday. Now, we are in Exodus chapter 36. We're almost to the end of the book. And a lot of this section of the book is describing the building of the tabernacle. All the instructions were already given to Moses on the mountain. And now the workmen are actually beginning work on it. They're moved in their hearts to do these things. Now this starts out in Exodus chapter 36, verse 1, saying, "Then wrought Bezaliel and Aholiab, and every wise-hearted man, in whom the Lord put wisdom and understanding, to know how to work all manner of work for the service of the sanctuary, according to all that the Lord had commanded." So here we see the same theme continuing from the last chapter. It was talking in the last chapter about the Lord moving on the people's hearts to give, and they willingly gave everything that was needed for the building of the tabernacle, the wood, the gold, the silver, the fabric, everything that they needed. And they were anxious. They were anxious to put their talents to use, especially these two workmen who were in charge of it, Bezaliel and Aholiab. Now, they were in charge of the craftsmanship of this whole thing, but they had others that were working under them. And Moses called Bezaliel and Aholiab and every wise-hearted man. They were wise in their hearts to do this, in whose heart the Lord had put wisdom, even everyone whose heart stirred him up to come unto the work to do it. So they were excited about doing this. And they received of Moses all the offering which the children of Israel had brought for the work of the service of the sanctuary, to make it withal. And they brought yet unto him free offerings every morning. Okay, so the people brought the offerings of all the materials that would be needed for the building of the tabernacle, and they brought it to Moses. They didn't bring it to the workmen. Moses was the go-between. He regulated the goods, I guess, that were used in the construction. Now, I wanted to bring this up in the last chapter, and it slipped my mind. I didn't put it into the notes. But this is a really important passage in Scripture that relates to what's going on here. In 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 7, the Apostle Paul said, "Every man according as he purposeth in his heart, so let him give. Not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loveth a cheerful giver," right? So here he's talking about when one gives to the Lord, to the work of the Lord, which is what they were doing here, that they should do it with a willing heart. And God even actually said, I think it was in the last chapter, that if they didn't give willingly, if they didn't want to give willingly, then don't give. It was, he only wanted these materials to be given from people who had a willing heart. Otherwise, he didn't want it. Isn't that interesting? So, I mean, it's the same way for us. If we're going to help somebody or give to any type of charity or giving an offering, say at your church or whatever, we shouldn't be doing that out of necessity, like it's our job to do it, like it's some kind of tithing law or something that we have to abide by. It shouldn't be done that way. Our gifts should be given because we want to do it, because we can't wait to do it, and it gives us joy to help, whatever that giving may be. It could be making a meal for somebody who needs it. somebody who's not able to do things themselves. Helping somebody who can't do things for themselves. There's all kinds of things that we can do to give. And if we aren't doing it out of a willing heart, then there's really not much point in doing it. And if we don't have a willing heart to do it, well, then we need to examine ourselves. And there's some correction that needs to be made in our spirits, right? But the offerings that were given here were the offerings that were needed for the tabernacle. It wasn't anything else. They were asked to specifically give specific things that were needed for the construction. The precious metals that they needed would be gold, silver, and brass, I think it was. I think those were the only three metals that they really used. And then they had the wood for the posts and the boards and for the Ark of the Covenant and for the table, for the furnishings that were inside the tabernacle. But as we see, they actually build the structure first before they build any of the furnishings, because those things have to be inside. So they had to actually build the structure of the holy place first before they built any of the furnishings that went in there. And all the wise men that wrought all the work of the sanctuary came every man from his work which they made. And they spake unto Moses, saying, the people bring much more than enough for the service of the work which the Lord commanded to make. They're saying they have too much. The people are giving too much. They gave more than enough. And Moses gave commandment, and they caused it to be proclaimed throughout the camp, saying, let neither man nor woman make any more work for the offering of the sanctuary. So the people were restrained from bringing. They actually had to tell them to stop giving. We don't need any more. Now, in reading this, I was thinking, what ministry nowadays would do that? I don't think there's many, really. Maybe there's some. But how many ministries would actually say, no, don't give us any more. You've brought enough. It's more than enough for our building fund or whatever it may be. Don't bring any more. I've never heard any church say that. But that's what they were saying. They only needed so much. They didn't want the people to keep bringing more when it wasn't needed, you know? And it makes sense. Verse 7. For the stuff they had was sufficient for all the work to make it, and too much. So some of it maybe they gave back to the people then, since it was too much. And every wise-hearted man among them that wrought the work of the tabernacle made 10 curtains of fine twined linen, and blue, and purple, and scarlet, with cherubims of cunning work made he them. The length of one curtain was 28 cubits, and the breadth of one curtain, 4 cubits. The curtains were all of one size. Now these curtains, they didn't like just hang vertically, they went over the whole building of the inner part of the tabernacle, the holy place. These curtains draped from the ground on one side, across the top, and down the other side. And he coupled the 5 curtains one unto another, and the other 5 curtains he coupled one unto another. I'm not going to go into depth about describing all this, because I did this in an earlier chapter. This is actually being repeated. Because when God gave the instructions to Moses on the mount, I went into more detail about it there, about what each thing was. Now here, it's kind of repeating it, because they're actually making it here. And like I said, of course, they would have to build the structure itself before they built the furnishings. And I think it's interesting how the fact that it's a tent makes it a temporary dwelling, right? Well, it needed to be mobile. So that's one part of it. But there's also a deeper spiritual meaning to it, really. The fact that it's mobile and it's a temporary structure. And I got thinking about this. And when you look at it and you think about a tent like that, especially at that time, who lived in tents? Well, a lot of people did then. Shepherds live in tents, and God is the shepherd of Israel, right? And also, soldiers live in tents, and the scriptures call the Lord a man of war. So there's a lot of different connections that you can make with this, and also the fact that we have no permanent dwelling here. The book of Hebrews talks about that. How here we have no permanent dwelling. Even our bodies themselves are temporary. We have a permanent home, but it's not here in this physical realm. So here, once again, this is not a permanent dwelling of God. Because, as we know, he doesn't dwell in things that are made with hands of men. You know? Verse 11, and he made loops of blue on the edge of one curtain, from the self edge in the coupling. Likewise, he made in the uttermost side of another curtain in the coupling of the second. 50 loops made he in one curtain, and 50 loops made he in the edge of the curtain which was in the coupling of the second. The loops held one curtain to another. And he made 50 tashes of gold, and coupled the curtains one unto another with the tashes. So it became one tabernacle. Now these were kind of like hooks and eyelets that it was hooked together with, kind of. But what's interesting here is that all these elements came together to make one. Just like all these strips of cloth that were the curtains that went over, and the posts and everything, there's all these different elements that went into the creating of this tabernacle. But when they were all put together, they made one. So likewise, this is like us in the body of Christ. We are brought together to make one body. In Ephesians chapter 4, verses 4 through 6, the Apostle Paul says, there is one body and one spirit, even as ye are called in one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in you all. So see, this can be taken individually with each one of us as an individual person. But on a larger scale, we can look at it like the different branches of Christianity now, because it's split into all these different denominations. But there's one commonality, and that is the Lord Jesus Christ and his divinity. That brings us all together, because there's one common thing among all these denominations that draw us together into one. Now, the world tries to bring all religions together into one. These don't mix. But all the different branches of Christianity that are truly part of the Lord's body are linked together as one. Verse 14. This really gets a little tedious, reading these instructions about the tabernacle. For one, we already read them, right? And also, it's a little bit hard for us to understand how it all went together. That's not really important. There's a reason for repeating these like this, and we'll get into that later on. But in verse 14, he goes on here and says, and he made curtains of goat's hair for the tent over the tabernacle. 11 curtains he made them. The length of one curtain was 30 cubits, and 4 cubits was the breadth of one curtain. The 11 curtains were of one size. And these all went over the linen. And he coupled 5 curtains by themselves and 6 curtains by themselves. And he made 50 loops upon the uttermost edge of the curtain in the coupling. And 50 loops made he upon the edge of the curtain which coupleth the second. And he made 50 tashes of brass to couple the tent together that it might be one. And he made a covering for the tent of ram skins dyed red, and a covering of badger skins above that. And I mentioned this before, when this was described before, that it's almost like a living thing. There's all these different layers of skin on it, kind of like how there's different layers of skin on us. And the outer layer was a badger skin. And then right underneath that was the ram skins, which were dyed red. Why did he want them dyed red? Other than the fact that if the outer part was torn, then you would see the red through there, kind of the same way that if you cut yourself, you see red, you see blood. I thought that was interesting. Now, this was totally weatherproof. You know, of course, first of all, you had the linen curtains, which had the royal colors on it, the blue and the red and the purple and the cherubims and whatnot that you would see from the inside. And then over that was the goat's hair curtains. And then over that were the ram skins dyed red. And then over that was the badger skin. So this was totally weatherproof. And the badger skin, it's not real definite what that actually was. In some translations, it translates it as dolphin skin, which I don't think that'd be correct because they were a long way from the sea. So it was some type of an animal that was an outer weatherproofing of it. But this whole structure was completely weatherproof from any type of storm or anything. It was very sturdy. In Isaiah chapter 4, verse 6, the prophet there said, "And there shall be a tabernacle for a shadow in the daytime from the heat, and for a place of refuge, and for a covert from storm and from rain." Now, the prophet there was speaking in the spirit. He's talking about what would be later on in the spirit. He wasn't talking necessarily about the literal tabernacle, you know. But going on here in verse 20, it says, "And he made boards for the tabernacle of shittim wood, standing up. The length of a board was 10 cubits, and the breadth of a board 1 cubit and a half. One board had 2 tenons equally distant one from another. Thus did he make for all the boards of the tabernacle. And he made boards for the tabernacle, 20 boards for the south side, southward, and 40 sockets of silver he made under the 20 boards, 2 sockets under one board for his 2 tenons, and 2 sockets under another board for his 2 tenons. And for the other side of the tabernacle, which is toward the north corner, he made 20 boards." Now, it's actually talking about the framework here of the tabernacle. "And there are 40 sockets of silver, 2 sockets under one board, and 2 sockets under another board. And for the sides of the tabernacle westward, he made 6 boards, and 2 boards made he for the corners of the tabernacle and the 2 sides. And they were coupled beneath and coupled together at the head thereof to one ring. Thus he did to both of them in both the corners." Okay, now this word coupled. Now it's said that quite a few times through this narrative here. And the word coupled, that's translated coupled, is the Hebrew word tayam. And what that actually means is doubled or twinned. So it's just what it sounds. In saying that it's coupled, it means there were 2 boards put together. "And there were 8 boards, and their sockets were 16 sockets of silver, under every board 2 sockets. And he made bars of shittim wood, 5 for the boards of the one side of the tabernacle, and 5 bars for the boards of the other side of the tabernacle, and 5 bars for the boards of the tabernacle for the sides westward. And he made the middle bar to shoot through the boards from the one end to the other." Okay, so they all linked together. "And he overlaid the boards with gold and made their rings of gold to be places for the bars, and overlaid the bars with gold." So the vertical boards had rings in them that the horizontal boards would slide through. There were no, like, screws or anything used in this. This was all made so that it could be disassembled. When it would be put up, it would be very sturdy, but it was relatively easy to break it down also. And when they moved, I imagine they would probably load it all on carts, I guess. I don't know. But considering it was mobile, that the whole thing could be moved, it was extremely sturdy. Like I said, I see all the individual pieces of this being put together like that, and they all interlock as being symbolic of us being different parts that link together to make one body in the spirit. And we see that several places in Scripture in the New Testament this is spoken of. In 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 5, the Apostle Peter said, "Ye also, as lively stones, are built up a spiritual house, an holy priesthood, to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God by Jesus Christ." And then, in Ephesians chapter 2, verses 19 through 22, the Apostle Paul says, "Now therefore, ye are no more strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and of the household of God, and are built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone, in whom all the building fitly framed together groweth unto an holy temple in the Lord, in whom ye also are builded together for an habitation of God through the Spirit." Amen. And in verse 35, it says, "And he made a veil of blue and purple and scarlet and fine twined linen with cherubims made he it of cunning work." What's interesting about this is with the cherubim, I'm wondering if back then Moses was shown these cherubim that are around the throne of God in order for them to even know what they look like, right? Because there were two cherubim on the top of the ark on the mercy seat. And then later when they build the temple, there's two real huge cherubim on either side of the Holy of Holies. And there were cherubims, images of cherubim all over the curtains, the linen. So how did they know what these looked like? They had to have known somehow. God would have had to reveal to them in the spirit what these cherubim looked like in order for them to make images of it. And nowadays, when we depict this scene, they just look like angels. You know, usually they have a human form with robes and wings and things like that. Now, there's a place in the scripture where the cherubim are described a little bit more in Ezekiel. In the book of Ezekiel, they're described right in chapter 1. And in Ezekiel 10, verse 20, the prophet said, "This is the living creature that I saw under the God of Israel by the river of Chebar," which is what he describes in the first chapter. "And I knew that they were the cherubim." Okay, so here Ezekiel is saying that these cherubim are the living creatures. The living creatures that surround the throne of God. There's four of them. And they have different faces. They have four different faces. And then they're described as being by these wheels. There's these wheels next to them. The wheel within a wheel with the eyes. So these are very strange creatures. They don't look like just what we would think of as an angel. These cherubim are the living creatures that surround the throne of God. All right? So that kind of gives you an entirely different idea of these images that would have been on the curtains, on the Ark of the Covenant. These weren't just like regular looking angels. These were the living creatures that surround the throne of God. It's just an interesting thought there. And of course, we don't know exactly what they look like unless it's been shown to us in the spirit. Some people claim to have seen them. I thought that was an interesting point there, that these cherubim were all over everything. They would have had to have known what they look like. And this was long before Ezekiel had his vision. This was about 1,000 years before that. So Moses had to have been shown these things. And I'm thinking when he was on the holy mountain, I think that maybe he was taken in to the throne room of God, maybe in the spirit. And he was shown a lot of these things. And of course, he didn't talk about it. He was a humble man, and he only talked about what he was told to talk about. If the Lord said, tell the children of Israel this, that's what he told them, and no more. You know? So we don't have a lot of insight into the things that Moses was actually shown. Verse 36. And he made thereunto 4 pillars of shittim wood, and overlaid them with gold. Their hooks were of gold, and he cast for them 4 sockets of silver. And he made an hanging for the tabernacle door of blue and purple and scarlet and fine twined linen of needlework. And the 5 pillars of it with their hooks, and he overlaid their chapiters and their fillets with gold. But their 5 sockets were of brass. Okay. This is very specific. This is very specific about how this was to be done. It had to be done a certain way. And it's repeated. Because we were told about it earlier, and now we're being told about it again. And always in Scripture, when things are repeated like that, there's a reason for it. There's a significance. So we need to take notice. The partition of the veil is an interesting element in this whole thing. There's a veil that separates the Holy of Holies from the holy place. And that's where the Ark of the Covenant would rest. And the table of showbread would be right outside of it. But this was symbolic of several things. And of course, there's several different veils. Into the holy place itself, only the priests were allowed to go. Which was where the showbread was at. And the altar of incense were in the holy place. Only the Levites, only the priests could go into that area. And then in the actual Holy of Holies, only the high priest could go in there once a year. So the veil symbolizes a few things here. Number one, it symbolizes the separation, I believe, between dispensations. For instance, back then at that time, this was all physical. They didn't understand the building of the temple of God in the spirit, which is what we are as the body of Christ. You know, like the passage I read there out of 1 Peter and out of Ephesians, where it talks about how we're built together a holy temple of God in the spirit. They didn't know any of these things. It was all just a physical thing to them. So that veil, for one, it symbolizes a little bit of that, because they couldn't see what was to come. They didn't know what was to come, that in Christ, that we would be elements of a holy temple in the spirit later on. They didn't know that. That was hidden from their eyes. So likewise, now, with us now, there's still a veil there, but it's between us now in this realm and what is to be later in the spirit, in the hereafter. We can only see so much of it. Just like I was saying with the cherubim, with the living creatures, we don't really know for sure what they look like. We know parts of Scripture where they're described vaguely, but we really don't know. And obviously then, maybe they were shown it and they knew a little bit more then. So this veil represents several things. And right now, I would say for us now, the veil really represents the flesh, the division between us here in this physical world and what we will be in the spirit in heaven. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you for this time together with my friends. And Lord, I just ask that you would give us understanding in all these things and reveal new and amazing truths out of your word. And we thank you for every little bit that we can get and every little bit of understanding that you show us as we go through this. Lord, I ask your blessing on these Bible studies, and I ask your blessing on each person listening in a special way. I give you all the glory in Jesus' name. Amen. All righty. Well, now we only have, let's see, 4 more chapters in the book of Exodus. And this section of it is really a little difficult because it runs through all different elements in the building of the tabernacle and all the directions that they got up until this point. But we're going to work our way through it. Amen. And I hope that you're blessed by it, because a lot of the parts of scripture, we look at it like, and we kind of skip over it. We say, well, that's really boring. I don't want to read about all that, the construction of stuff. But when you really look into it, there's a lot of really precious little spiritual morsels that you can pull out of every section of scripture. But I love you all, and like this video, share, subscribe, and I thank you for it, and I'll see you the next time around. Bye-bye. Deeper, deeper in the love of Jesus.